And I'm also finishing up The Problem with Forever, which comes out in May 17th of 2016, Harlequin Contemporary. It's YA contemporary, very much in the vein of the Wait For You series, but young adult.
I am currently revising the second book in a new series that I have coming out. The first one's coming out in January of 2016 called Never Tear Us Apart. And it's kind of, it's angsty and dark and different from what I've written in the past, only because, I don't know, it's just a little bit closer.
Yes.
I'm
excited about this.
Yeah.
Sidebar.
Oh, yeah.
And so the second book will be out in May, so that's why I'm revising that one right now.
I'm writing a Christian novella, and it's been really cold because it's been 90 degrees in LA, 95 degrees, and it's like the hotter it gets outside, the colder I make it in the book. So it's like, yeah, they just took a hike in the woods during a snowstorm, and they're really cold right now. And a lot of wishful thinking. But that's called Holiday Kisses, and it's sort of a spin-off from my Beach of Bay series, because that came to a close this year. So it's one of the characters from Beach of Bay off in a new location, and that's out December 4th.
We will have time for your questions, of course, today. We will also have times for photos with the authors. But meanwhile, the non-reading glasses younger Stacy is going to take over the questions while I take some photographs.
All right, ladies. What's the most surprising thing that has ever happened when you were writing? Has there ever been a moment when you thought, I did not see that coming?
I'm a plotter. I don't know if you know about plotting and pantsing. So I always try and outline before I start so that I don't get any unexpected surprises that mean I have to wrap the first half of the book. But I think sometimes if you've like had like secondary characters and they just pop and you kind of end up wishing the book was about them and you have to like immediately plan a spin-off book for them. So that's happened to me where you get way more interested by people who are like in
I am not a plotter. I fly by the seat of my pants, so I'm surprised quite often. But I will say that when I wrote One Week Girlfriend, I had no plans to do anything for Fable's brother in that book. He was like a character I needed to put in there to give her somebody to care about. So he was a big surprise, I would say. So kind of same scenario.
I'm also I don't plot. I tried it once. It ended badly. I can't do it. I envy you though.
You know what's fun? Not writing and then realizing you have to like scrap the last week's work because you've written yourself into a corner. Like that's really fun.
Yeah. I just did that from forever. I scrapped 75,000 words. So I scrapped 80-some thousand words. Yeah. So if it happens and you don't
like,
plot.
You just like
Okay. No, the two things that I've been most surprised about is one of the examples is like for the Lux series when I didn't know what the aliens looked like when I was writing it like 50 or 60%. I kept besides the attractive human voice version of it, but the true form, I kept picturing giant insects from like Independence Day, and I was like, that's not hot. So I've never thought of the movie Cocoon, where they glow in the pod in the pool, and that's where I came up with light. But I had no idea that obsidian, onyx, or opal actually does what I say it does in the book in real life. I had no idea. I thought I was making something clever up. And then apparently if they all do refract light, and no idea. But we pretend that. And then with the power, there is a huge plot twist at the end that Stacy knows. That literally came out of left field. And I was like, oh my God, this is perfect. And so that's a good thing I think about sometimes not plotting, is that you feel that you can turn a book on it. You can turn a book when it's in. You know what I mean? And you don't feel like you're stuck to it. So.
Right. Which part of the creative and writing process do you enjoy most?
Not the first draft. The first draft is always terrible because you're staring at a blank page. So I like editing. I like thinking up the idea in the first place, because then it's like playing a movie in your head, and you're like, oh, this is gonna happen. And then I like going back once you have a terrible first draft, because then you're like, oh, I can fix this. It's terrible, but I can fix it. Whereas
doing it from scratch is always really, really tough.
So favorite process? Yeah, I would say the beginning. The middle always is like, the middle now.
Mid-book crisis.
Yeah, I have mid-book crisis a lot. Or what I'll do is I'll get about 60% in and I'm like, what happened in the first part? I don't remember anything that happened in the first part. So, but I would say the actual beginning is always fun because it's fresh and new.
And you're getting to know these
new characters. Yeah. So it's fun to start.
Agreed. I have what Stacy and I call Stacy is my best friend. She's also my assistant, so she reads behind me as I write. So she knows more about the books than I do sometimes. Like, people will ask me something online, and I'll be like, Stacy, what are they talking about? I've read 30 books since then. No, but I have mid-book crisis, and I get to the middle of every book, and I hate it. I hope all the characters die. And I don't care. Just be like, twist, everyone's dead. But it's because I think, like you said in the beginning, you're happy, you're new, it's exciting. But then in the middle, that's when you start to worry, is everything going to come together? And even I think if you plot it, you're still.
Oh, yeah.
And then I think sometimes you get bored in the middle.
Yeah.
And then you're like, oh crap, I'm bored.
Yeah.
Like, y'all are going to be bored.
I usually know the ending and I love the beginning. And then I'm like, but I have to somehow fill all of these thousands of words. Can they just get together already?
I enjoy editing. I know a lot of people hate editing, a lot of authors do. I think that's the easiest part of it. It's just because I edit as I write. So I don't write, I don't fast draft. So I don't, do you guys know what fast drafting is?
Vomiting words.
Basically, yeah. So they'll have, like, their book will be only 50 or 60,000 words, if that, or 40,000 words. And then they go back in during the editorial process and they flesh everything out. And then build and catch mistakes, but I could not move forward.
I couldn't either. I don't do that.
Knowing something's wrong.
No, but sometimes you have to like leave a bit. So sometimes I'll go back. Like I said everything to my friend and my agent beforehand, and she's like, it just says insert witty banter right now. So like
insert sexy banter right now. I'm like, big kiss.
I know you all probably have questions, so I have one more question for all five of you, and then just a quick game of Would You Rather for the models.
I've heard these questions.
It's clean.
I was like,
give it to the audience.
So, for all five of you, what is the last book that you read that you just couldn't put down?
Gosh, we're terrible.
I think authors are always writing.
No, I did.
Joanna Wild's last book, Reaper. No, Silver Bastard. That is the name of the title, not the person. That'll be later.
Guys.
Mine was The Return. What? Opposition.
Did ask for Oblivion. He's like, when can I get Oblivion? I'm like,
I knew they were gonna say that. That's why I asked the question. Alright guys, these are for you. Would you rather be hairy all over or completely bald?
Hairy.
Yeah, same.
You can trim it if you want, yeah.
Trim it.
I trim him. Trim me.
Alright, that just got weird.
Would you rather go about your normal day naked or sleep for a year?
What was the second one?
Or sleep for a year? Naked? I know Drew's answer.
What is it?
It's naked.
You can't even find your shirt in the naked.
Have you ever seen a picture of this guy with a shirt on?
I mean, this is shocking right here.
All right. Would you rather use sandpaper for toilet paper or vinegar for eye drops?
KP.
I didn't.
Terrible. What was the second one?
Vinegar for eye drops.
What grade was that paper in?
Fine grade.
Fine grade, yes.
Those both sound awful.
Well, you have to pick one. That's the game.
I would do sandpaper.
Pepe, you have concrete.
Smart guy.
Okay, so would you rather
rather begin every sentence with "woolly alien babies" or "hey, do you want to be my cuddle bunny?"
It's obvious. Yeah. Cuddle bunny. It's obvious.
Would you rather be able to turn invisible or be able to fly?
I know. I like fly.
Would you rather live in the Harry Potter universe or in the Twilight universe?
Harry Potter.
Oh my gosh. I can't think of Harry Potter Twilight fandoms.
Wizards or vampires?
I've had to watch the Vampire Diaries lately, so I go quiet.
No, they decided they were going to change the cover series, the cover from the series and the last book in the series, which I was so excited about. But Australia, and you can order it on Book Depository, they have the actual cover that matches the first two books in the series. But originally, the Everlast Breath cover had Zane, Roth, and Layla on it, and then Barnes & Noble kicked the cover back and said it was too romancy, and I was like, is this like a threesome? I mean, it's a young adult, guys, come on, that does not symbolize romance. It actually kind of looked action-y because, like, her hair was blowing, they looked like they were, like, about to kick butt, and apparently that was too romancy. But there is one version that you can get, it's Australian, and it has the cover that
and they ship free.
Yes. Yeah, and if you go to Amazon, I don't know if you guys realize this, but you can order foreign editions off regular Amazon. Mm-hmm. I didn't know that. I ordered a bunch of German Dark Elements because they redid the cover over there. Cool. So I didn't know that you can go on there if they have
Australian ones also now.
Probably because it's us Americans, we're like, this cover doesn't match the rest of the series, Harlequin. Mainly because, especially when it's several books deep, like the Covenant series and the Lux series are, you know, there are five books, full-length books, and you just get kind of tired of the characters a little bit, because you've written yourself into corners, and now you have a good idea, but you can't do it because you've written yourself into a corner with it. I'm probably going to have to say The Covenant because it was my first series, but it does tie with the Lux series because that is, you know, my most popular YA series, so, and it's in that world now that I've finished it and that there's been a break from me, because I think sometimes you need a break and you need time separated from it. It's fun to think about going back to it and what you can do that makes, because I don't think you should spin off a series unless you can do something completely different with it. That's my personal opinion. So it's interesting to think of once you've been disconnected from it a lot.
Right, because you don't want to tell the same story over and over again. But sometimes it's like you need to leave the town. I mean, it's like living in a town for a really long time. Yeah. You're like, you know it by heart. And it stops being fresh and there's not really anything left to discover as an item. And then you leave, and it's like leaving your hometown, and then you go back and visit, and you're like, oh,
I missed it. Yeah. I missed these bumpy roads.
Those
are
interesting.
Yes, ma'am.
Have you always wanted to be a writer?
I mean, I was pretty much scribbling in notebooks in the back of the files. I was about, like, 9 or 10 years old, and I wrote my first novel when I was 19, and I have no other skills. I've been doing nothing but writing books since I left college, and if I tried to do anything else, I'd probably wind up flat on my face. So I just keep writing.
Yeah, I was a big reader, big reader, and I wanted to be a writer from probably late teens, and then, you know, real life gets in the way, you work a dreary job, and have kids, and then I realized, hey, you know, I'm going to give this a shot. So yeah, I did always want to be one.
Yeah, I always wanted to be a writer. My first thing I attempted to write was poetry. I wrote it on my bedroom walls in permanent marker, and it was really bad, and I don't know what it was, but it was like the haunted permanent marker, because like no matter how many times my parents like painted over it, I swear it like bled back through. But I wrote my first book in algebra class, and when I was 14, it was either called The Forbidden Ones or The Forgotten Ones. It was terrible, but I ended up having to take remedial math in college because I did not at all pay attention in math class, so I suggest not doing that. But like with Monica, I went to college and then I focused on psychology and I did that for a while and I was like, this is not for me. I'm too much, I think, of a realist sometimes for that field. But no, it's something I always wanted to do and I was grateful when I finally started doing it again.
Any other questions?
I got time. Don't forget to ask.
I actually had a question for Drew and Heavy. Do you identify with your characters in the books at all? Is there anything that you find similar?
Yeah, a lot of books. I think also after reading the book, kind of pick up little qualities that you like and also ones you dislike. So kind of makes you want to pursue those qualities if you like them. And the ones that you don't like, obviously, you kind of like that. But,
how do you think?
I do have a lot of things, I'm just a better guy in real life.
not a jerk.
That is true.
David does redeem himself.
But the character, being a black, is a good guy. In the beginning, he's a little jerk.
I can say, like, the story of Pepe, I didn't pick the cover, the publisher did, and, you know, immediately when she said the first cover, the old school, does anybody have the old school cover here? Can you hold it up? When they sent the first old school cover here, no, the older one, the first edition.
Oh, there was one.
Yes. Yeah, it's Pepe and Stella kind of facing each other a little bit, like they're kind of like that in it. It was just shocking how much he resembled the character, like description-wise. It was very eerie. And then, like when you had reached out to me, I did not believe that it was him, because people on the internet are weird. And I'm like, he says, you know. Then you showed me, I think you sent a link to your Facebook page, and I realized it was you. So then I giggled, because I was like, oh my God, that's really him. And, but then I felt really weird, because like, oh my God, he's probably going to think I saw his picture and like model the character after him. And then, because it was, you know, because the physical resemblance was kind of shocking a little bit. And then with Drew, his personality is so much like Seth, though. Like, the first time we met, it was so much like Seth. It was that, very much so.
But just like the kind of smart alecky, you know, always has something to say. It was kind of eerie a little bit because you'd be like, this is so weird. Like, you're just kind of like it.
Any other questions?
For the guys, did you ever write a song before you were featured in the white?
I did it. I'm not a very big reader, so this is like the first book I've read.
This is the first.
Audiobooks.
Audiobooks
are really
cool.
They
should have brought the book in comedy because it's so sad.
My book?
Yeah.
He's
yeah.
hard on
the book.
Oh
my gosh, he brings
in.
Oh, dude, it's like twisted. And it's like, I was like, what are you doing to this book? And you're in it.
Pages.
Yeah,
it's well loved.
It's well, yeah. It's well very loved. Well loved.
Anybody else?
Don't be shy.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. What time is it? No, so I've been always wanting to get a tattoo, and I, first off, didn't want to get one done because I have no tolerance to pain, and so I'm like, why can't they just numb the skin? And they're like, no, the whole part of the tattoo process is to feel the pain. I'm like, no. I just want to look pretty on my skin. I'm not here for deeper meaning. But I couldn't commit to what I wanted to get done. And then I heard about the semicolon project. And now the semicolon, it stands for a lot of different things. It's not just mental health awareness. I think it actually stands for Crohn's disease, too. A lot of people have that tattooed. But I felt that, you know, that was something that meant something. And I like the meaning behind it, where it's basically a semicolon separates two sentences. So instead of choosing to end one sentence, you continue. So in the meaning of it is that instead of like ending your life or somebody you know, you chose to continue. And so I thought that was a very powerful thing. And if I was gonna get my first tattoos, I felt like at least it means something. And this, sometimes those quiet moments could be heaven, it's from Scorched. So I felt that matched. And then on the side, it's just dialogue tags, which we had such a hard time getting correct. Oh, well, we didn't have it on right. I'm like, I use Microsoft Word. I don't know how that's positioned correctly. And luckily, there is an English teacher with me, my friend. She's like, don't put down the body wrong. And I'm like, it's wrong? I'm like, I don't know. Microsoft Word just looks like it's this, but it's not. It's yeah. like this, and I didn't know that.
But do other of you have tattoos?
Oh, God, no.
I don't have one. It does not hurt that bad. No, it didn't. I mean, I got all of them. I'd done it one time. I was like, oh, this is not bad. So they were like, are you sure? I'm like, tattoo me up.
Okay, I was like, let's do this.
If you were forced to get a tattoo, what would you get?
So it's really, really small and doesn't.
It does. No, you don't want. It does start to sting closer. I notice you get to your wrist.
Oh, okay.
Sure.
So like,
yeah.
You don't have a tattoo.
I don't. I almost got one when I was in college, and I just went back out.
Oh, what's yours?
Oh, it's very
Oh, big. I like that. Every time I would do signings with Cora Carmack and Jay Fromover, Jay doesn't go and get tattoos because she's very particular because she has so many tattoos. She only goes to a certain tattoo person. But Cora, every single freaking time,
let's go get a tattoo.
I'm like, no.
Gamble
and get a tattoo. I'm like, how old are you for? And she will stay up all night gambling and getting tattoos.
Oh, yeah.
But she almost had me talked into it in Dallas, and I almost did it, but then I was like, well, I don't know how to take care of one. Like, I figured it was a bigger production than it really is. So I didn't get it done then, but now that I finally got it, Cora's like, every day she's like, oh, we're getting a tattoo now. Next time, you can't chicken out of it. But I was surprised. I'm going to get her name tattooed.
Yeah.
I'm going to do signature.
Cora forever.
But it's, I was surprised that it doesn't, I mean, I know it hurts on certain places of the body. Like, my friend has one on her foot. She said it was horrible.
I've heard that's
horrible on her foot. The tattoo artist who did me had one in her armpit.
What?
Which I don't even understand why you would do that. But she said it was horrible. powerful. She was crying, yeah, and she is the tattoo artist. So, but it just kind of feels like a cat scratching you repeatedly. I mean, no, there was no, but not that bad. But there was a moment where I started to want to pull my arm back. Like, it's when they start going back over it, is when it starts to hurt. And I had to remind myself that I'm doing this to myself on purpose. Don't move your arm. This is there. But then there was somebody else beside me who was getting their entire back tattooed as a son, all in black ink. And they had to stop, and he had to get up and stand up every couple, like every 10 minutes. And I don't know why, but apparently it was the amount of ink that was going in, and he just had to stop and, you know, get up and walk around and lay back down. And I was like, okay, I can do this.
Before we start the signing, like, what do you have coming out next? And can you give us any reasons for this?
So I have my Christmas novella coming out in December, and it's just delightful.
I like to do my Christmas novellas with, like, a whole month maybe, but with, like, a little extra sexiness. And then in February, it's an adult novel. It's under a different name. It's called The Oxford Inheritance, and it is a Oxford Secret Society murder mystery with demonic possession. So that'll be really fun. So if you liked, like, Deb Hopness or kind of like the secret history, then that's kind of going to be like it. That's in February.
I have the first in my two-book series, January 5th, coming out. That's Never Tear Us Apart. And it's kind of got a romantic suspense, thriller type of aspect. A lot of it's told in the past and in the present.
Really good.
Yeah, it's met when they were teenagers in a very horrible circumstance, and then they reunite later. So that's what's coming out next
week. For me, I have Oblivion coming out December 1st, I think, or the 2nd. I think it's the 1st. I don't know. But it's the first three books in the Lux series told in Damon's POV. But just remember, the print version only has Obsidian in it, and the digital version has all three. However, the price of both of them together is still less than two books. So you're really getting. So if you really want the reason why they had to do that is because those three books was 1,300 pages long. So the digital version is over 1,300 pages. It was not cost effective for them. It's basically, it was two of the bound versions over there that she has, is how big, and it was not cost effective. It would have cost them a lot of money to produce that book, and they would have charged a ridiculous amount for it. So the way they came up with it was, if for people who were super fans, if they really wanted it in print, they can get the Obsidian, and then if you really don't want that, then you just buy the digital. But then again, the price of both of them is not even more than $15, $15 or $16. So they worked really hard on trying to keep it where it wasn't like you're paying for so a lot of stuff. So, and then The Power comes out February the 23rd, I believe. So that's the second book in the Penguin series. Also, at the end of Oblivion, there's something in there. I think you guys might like. No, it's not the freaking note on it. Any other questions? Truest, you're doing trailers for the Titan series. We did not know, Pepe and I did not know, we were both going to be in LA until Thursday as I'm sitting at the airport. He's like, what are you doing going to LA? I'm like, I'm going to book signing and film chasing. So am I. Together. There's some stuff coming related to the Lux series that is, I don't even know how much I can talk about this. I saw an announcement, but I don't think it went to detail. So I can't really talk a lot about it, but if you already have Obsidian digital book, there's going to be an update coming through that you're going to want to update. And then Oblivion digital has some stuff, cool stuff embedded into the digital files. That is very cool. I can't even say what it is because I'll give it away. But because I had to sign like a
but it's.
I know, right? Over and over, not saying anything. But I've seen the and Stacy was in the room when she saw it. I've seen something, so it's really cool that has to do with that. And I hope, I think there's going to be, you know, interesting Lux movie news coming soon. So ish.
Any other questions?
What about Torn?
Torn is actually on hold right now. And the reason being is when I wrote Wicked, I did not have the workflow that I did now. And then in spring this year, I realized I had to write, I'll be honest, I had to fulfill a contract that I did not realize I still had to fulfill. And so between me and the publisher, we decided to create Oblivion. So Oblivion was only ever supposed to be Obsidian POV, which would have allowed me to continue working on.